I'm making this video because someone sent me a friend request recently, and I went to the channel and I investigated them as I always do, and I noticed he has a video up in which he's proclaiming that Jesus Christ is a separate entity and he's not God himself. This video is for you, my friend. I have great news for you. Jesus Christ is God, manifest in the flesh. He is a living Word of God. The Word came alive and dwelt among us. I'm going to provide for you some passages in the Bible that make it unarguably clear that Jesus Christ is God, not just a separate entity called the Son, but He was God, is God, the Father, He is the Holy Ghost, He is the Son. He is all three at once. These three are not separate personalities. Some Christians argue that God has three personalities. There's three persons. That's false. That's a lie that came into Christianity through the Roman Catholic Church within 3 centuries of Christ's death and resurrection. God does not have three personalities. He has one personality. He is one person. God states, I do not change. In the Old Testament, He states it. He states in the New Testament, God is unchanging. You see, for God to have more than one personality means He has to change from one personality to another to do whatever work in this world He wants to do. God has one personality. The Holy Ghost, which comes unto Christians, is Jesus Christ. It is also the Father. You see, it's difficult for humans, us humans, to understand that, because Jesus was being baptized, you see, in the River Jordan, and the Father appeared through voice and said, "This is my Son in whom I am well pleased." Well, how is it that God would talk to Himself about Himself and be present in physical flesh? You see, this is something that man is not fully capable of comprehending, understanding about God. God is omniscient. He is everywhere at all times. He can be anywhere. He can be two places at once. He can do things we would call crazy because He's God. He has no limitations. All things are possible with God. And some Christians have difficulty understanding how God could do something like this, how Jesus prayed to Himself in the garden when He learned of the task, when He was considering the task before Him to be crucified and horribly tortured and to die for the sins of mankind, where He sweat blood because of the tremendous emotional stress. Well, how can God experience such stress? Because He's God, you see. He can be anywhere at all times. He can be in two places at once and be the same. So Jesus was praying unto Himself, not a second separate personality. He's praying unto Himself, you see. This is something that we humans have difficulty understanding. But I'm going to prove to you that Jesus Christ is God, that God is one and one personality. This lie of three persons, this Trinity thing, is not in Scripture. God is one. Jesus Christ is God. Pay attention if you want to see the truth, and I will help you see it. Stick with me. In the beginning, here's the Bible. Genesis 1. The first three lines of the Bible tell us that God manifests Himself in three ways, not three persons, with three personalities. You see, to have a personality means to be a separate person, to be a person. God is not three persons. Genesis 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. God, that's the Father. Genesis 1:2, the second line in the Bible, states, "And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters." What is the Spirit of God? This is the Holy Ghost. And the third line of the Bible states, "And God said, Let there be light, and there was light." And what is light? Well, who is the light of this world? Jesus Christ. And the fourth line of the Bible, it goes on to say, "And God saw the light, and it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness." Immediately in the creation, God knew that evil would come because it is an absence of His presence. By God creating this physical world, instantly He created the presence, the opportunity for evil to exist, because God created a physical, tangible, three-dimensional world in which His presence would not always be in a physical form, you see. And evil is an absence of the presence of God, you see. Without God in their hearts, the heart of man is deceitfully wicked and prone to evil. Even we, humans, and I'm not just talking about the angels that sinned against God and were cast out, like Satan. I'm talking about even human beings. Without God in their life, we are driven to turn toward evil and away from God, because only God is good, Jesus Himself said. And if God is not present in your life, there will be no evil, the good. There can be no good. So here in the first four lines, of the Bible, God tells us that He separated the light from the darkness, and that He created the opportunity for evil to exist by creating a place in which His light could be or not be. You see, the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, all three, in the first three lines of the Bible. Hebrews 9:26 says, "For then He must often have suffered since the foundation of the world, but now once in the end the world hath He appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of Himself." This is God, this is Jesus Christ, suffered since the foundation of the world. Do you remember what I said? Genesis 1:4 stated that God created light and separated the light from the darkness. God created the opportunity for the presence of evil by creating a three-dimensional world in which His presence, His light, could be or not be. Where God's light is not, there will be evil, because evil is an absence of the presence of God's light. And Jesus Christ is the light of the world. So here God says, He sacrificed Himself. Okay, now Colossians 2 states, "Beware, lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. For in Him dwelleth the fullness of the Godhead bodily." This is a very important scripture. First, it warns us that people are going to vainly philosophize away even the properties, the characteristics, the nature of God Himself, you see. "Beware, lest any man spoil you through vain deceit, after the tradition of men." See, where did this tradition of Trinity, of three entities, God being three entities, three spirits, three separate entities? See, it gets very confusing, because many Christians claim that God is one spirit, but yet He has three personalities, three persons. That's a self-conflict right there. It's hypocrisy. Okay? But He warns us, and the very next line states, "For in Him dwelleth the fullness of the Godhead bodily." So we get a warning that people are going to try to deceive you and follow the vain traditions of men, which entered into the church in the first couple of centuries after Christ, that God had three personalities. And states that in Him dwelled the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Now what does that mean? The fullness of the Godhead bodily. That means Christ, the flesh, the man. In Him was the fullness of the Godhead. That means within Him was God the Father, God the Holy Ghost, and God the Son. All three in one, you see. Because Jesus Christ is God. He's merely a manifestation of God in this world, in a three-dimensional, physical, tangible form. The fullness of the Godhead. Not part of it. Doesn't say a little bit of God here and a little of the Holy Spirit and maybe none of the Father. No. The recipe, you see, is the fullness of the Godhead. That means all of the Father, all of the Holy Ghost, and all of the Son were in Jesus Christ, fully and bodily. When Jesus walked this earth as a man, He was God Himself walking the earth. God, the one who created it Himself, walking upon His creation. Colossians 2 states, "For I would that ye knew what great conflict I have for you, for them at Laodicea, and for as many as have not seen my face in the flesh, that their hearts might be conformed, being knit together in love, and unto all the riches and of the full assurance of understanding, to the acknowledgment of the mystery of God, and of the Father, and of Christ. See, this is alluding that God, Christ, is God, you see. And I say, and this I say, lest any man should beguile you with enticing words. For though I be absent in the flesh, yet I am with you in spirit. Spirit, the Holy Ghost. Joying and beholding your order and in the steadfastness of you, of your faith in Christ, you see. 2 John 1:9 states, whosoever transgresseth and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ hath not God. He that abideth in the doctrine of Christ, he hath both the Father and the Son. Galatians 4:6 states, and because ye are sons, God hath sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, saying, crying, Abba, Father. The Spirit of his Son, this is the Holy Ghost, crying, Abba, Father. Who? Father. Christ is our Father. He is God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. John 10:30 states, I and my Father are one. Not three. Does not say, I and my Father have two different personalities. No. I and my Father are one. They are the same. Didn't say alike, or somewhat alike, or we're kind of different. No. One. They are the same. Timothy 3:16 states, and without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. See, this is what I was referring to. We cannot, as humans, mortals with their little puny minds, cannot really comprehend this power, majesty of God, wherein God can be three places at once, or any place, number of places at once. He can be three manifestations of himself, which he conceived before the creation of the world, to convey his, to do his work in the world, you see. We cannot truly understand that, see. People get stumbled up on that. But it says, and great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, and received up into glory. Who? God. Says, and without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. See, we can't really understand this about God, but, and then it goes on to say, God was manifest in the flesh. God, not the Son, it doesn't say. God was manifest in the flesh. Who is the flesh? Christ. Justified in the Spirit, he is the Holy Ghost also, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, and believed on in the world, and received up into glory. God, that is one of the most important passages probably in the entire Bible. Without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the Spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up into glory. Great is the mystery of godliness. See, here he's saying, we cannot fully understand this thing about God. But here's how it goes down. God himself, he says, was manifest in the flesh, that is Christ Jesus, justified in the Spirit, that is Jesus Christ. And you know what? That's how God saves us. He justifies us by wiping away all the sins of our entire life. We are justified. God looks at us and says, I see one who has no sin. Anyway, so preached on unto the Gentiles. You see, God calls it a mystery. God doesn't have three personalities. He's one. I and my Father are one.